This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today on Dreamland, we're talking to one of the most remarkable people I know. He is a close friend of Prince Stash Dirola, who was on a few weeks ago, who proved to be one of the more interesting guests we've had in a long time. And we're going to find the same experience here, but in a very different way. Leigh is the author of what I regard as the most extraordinary book on the Tarot ever written. It's called The Tarot Revisioned, and we'll be talking about that during the course of the show. Leigh is in his studio. Leigh is an artist. He has been an actor in the past, and probably could still act for us if he wished to. He is the spirit, guiding spirit of two study groups that I'm in. One of them is the on Tuesday nights we meet and we discuss various books, and on Thursday night we meet again and we have been discussing the Pistis Sophia. And Leigh is one of the most powerful intellects I know, who explores the edge of, I would say, the conventional world. And he is sitting in his studio, known as the Hieroglyph of the Human Soul. And I think that we'll circle back to your acting career, but I think the first thing we need to talk about probably is the Hieroglyph, Leigh. Can you tell us a little bit about why it is that you're sitting in a chair that appears to have a crane painted on it in a room that seems to be completely covered with art? It's a very unusual space. And as we go along in the show, I'll from time to time pull up images from the Hieroglyph so that you can see it as we go along. It's a remarkable space. But tell us first about the basics of the Hieroglyph. But before we go there, what's that crane all about?
Well, the crane, the heron, is it's connected to this story of the Hieroglyph of the Human Soul. And it was actually a visitation in 2005 where the heron came into my house. We spent 30 minutes together. He was on my couch. And there was a revelation at hand that had to do with the return of the phoenix. And you asked about the painting here, is that this began, my Hieroglyph of the Human Soul, began on 9/11, 2001, when the towers came down. And a little background about this room, as you know, Whitley, we meet here outside of the pandemic, but we meet in a circle. And we've done this over the years here. I've done this for 41 years. And so everything we talk about, I really love to stress the truth that art is the language of creation. This is my home. And when we see both of those qualities, we start to think of, well, what do we hold sacred? And I have loved this gathering over the years where people like ourselves, we're always showing up. And as you say, let's just explore ideas. Let's try to inspire one another rather than fatigue each other with our opinion of things. Let's allow ourselves to see where this takes us. And why I, all of the work, and you're talking about my tarot that precedes the Hieroglyph of the Human Soul, because I spent 17 years on that beginning in the early 1980s and then publishing in 2003. But it was really mostly done in 2001, when the towers came down. It was a story that even in my tarot, there had been a type of mythic prediction, because it is dated 9/11, 1986, and it is the world archetype. And the world archetype in my drawing has twin pillars, twin towers, essentially. And it was the beginning of the conversation that the conversation of the outer world allows us to navigate those circumstances. But in this location, in this place, in my home, we, for all of these years, have been saying, at least here, amongst us, let these things matter. It seems as if they rarely matter to the outer world, so let us cultivate a place where these things can grow. And that's why from the heron visiting to stones that have come to me, to revelations from my Phoenix Arise painting and it creating mandalas and a holographic DNA, none of this was my work illustrating anything, but the outcome of a great devotion to saying, at least here, these things I will honor. And that's why on 9/11, coming back to the hieroglyph of the human soul, is that a language erupted through my hand and through my breath as I fell on my knees, like I think a lot of us did in that collapse, in that despair, and a language called the Watcher language emerged. And like a jazz musician, I started leaning into the riff. I never knew where it was going, but as it unfolded over the years, and about a year into it, my friend Don Estes asked me if I'd looked at it with 3D glasses because he was convinced it was 3D. And lo and behold, it is multidimensional when you put on 3D glasses.
That is one of the most remarkable things about it, and one of the most remarkable things I've ever seen, Leigh. You had no idea that it was 3D.
Not at all.
And he's a special effects artist, right?
Yeah, well, you know, it's very interesting. Yeah, Don works with virtual reality, with 3D, with sound. He has the Vibra sound, this relationship to the immersive nature of his work. So he is working in a different way, similar in that both of our questions are about not looking at something from the outside, but how do you engage the individual so it is immersive? And the 3D effect was completely unexpected, but my questions were about the multidimensional nature of consciousness, about how do we explore these qualities that we cannot become multidimensional. We are in a three-dimensional form, but with the imagination, this becomes our bridge. And my father, who was a painter, would always say, when you can't talk about something, paint it. So I started painting, and as I followed this weave of the Watcher language, Kuan Yin, the Chinese mother goddess, was the first to appear essentially through my hand, through my breath, on the linoleum floor. And she started a story within me that engaged the question of, a bit like Joseph Campbell, what happens after the hero's journey? What happens when you return home? What happens with all of the armor? How do you learn not to bring that into where you live, into the sacred nature of what you love? And so the question, again, the visual is I'm on my knees. I'm in a type of child state, meaning I'm not looking down from scaffolding. I'm looking up. And I really feel that shift in perspective started to indicate what had happened on 9/11 itself, that the twin towers of, or the brothers of the Piscean Age, the false erections of money and God, came crashing down. The sense that I have more than you do, and I will rise. Do you see, like the towers of Babel? And they collapse, and we're left on our knees. And I was left on my knees in the studio on the linoleum floor. And over the last 21 years, it has grown from covering the floor to covering the furniture to covering the ceiling to covering the books. You know, as I like to say, if you're going to go mad, you might as well go all the way. Don't resist, just let it out. So it flowed over the years. And I really feel that the story it's telling us is that the last key is intimate. The last key is the question of how do we live with our myths? And what I love here, like you can see with this chair, with my friend the heron, Thoth, whispering in my ear, I like to live with these questions. And it turns out
you sure do. Like,
you know, yes. Yeah.
Folks, I'm going to just ask Leigh a sort of a basic question here that I know is in everybody's mind. Who are the Watchers you refer to in your mind?
If I can really give I'll give some images. In 1988, I did a painting called The Watchers. And I was very interested in, because I had created in a work called Ascension, and before that, a few other successful paintings that I very much liked, but I was also hosting a theosophy discussion group, and I started to feel that one of the problems with the higher self, lower self, is that everything north of the, you know, bow tie, so to speak, is fine. Everything south is a little dodgy. And I thought I really wanted to understand not the nature of the spiritual as something, you know, that says, ah, but really the universe as organism. And so I started painting and I started asking about the organic nature of sentience, meaning when we cut ourselves, a formula does not come out of us. We are not mathematics abstract. Blood comes out of us. So in that, I started to think about, all right, well, I want to know about that borderland, that question of energy itself, that if it is projected into, it becomes something negative. If it is projected into with something positive, it becomes something positive. And this is where the watchers began to naturally emerge in my artwork. And they were elongated figures that never had a face, but hooded figures that were, and I was informed that they were the quality of consciousness that was not about the personality, about the persona, but actually about the essential energies or the weavers of creation. And so the watchers become, essentially, you would say, the living strings, the vibratory qualities. Like we think of string theory, we think of particle and wave, but we rarely think of it in terms of sentience. We think of it in terms of energy. But when we think in terms of energy and sentience, we begin to perceive the nature of archetype and the watchers, because it's saying what you do not see, it is not that it is not there, like the watchers, but actually it is that which creates the container for whatever choices you make. And therefore, the more you begin to allow this other quality, which we might call synchronicity, association, strange relationships, to have a place in the conversation, this is where the watchers become an informing presence. Because, and I like this, they say inwardly that we never intrude. We will not show up and give you a face, because if we do, you will have someone to blame and you will think it is not you. We remind you that you are not alone, but the grace that's been given to you is we will not intrude on a good choice or a bad choice. You are the artist of your own destiny. What we are reminding you is your resource is, if you don't like the story you're telling, tell better stories, because we are the whole cloth. We are that which you weave with. And that's why the hieroglyph of the human soul is written in the watcher language, which is inherently multidimensional. And although fixed every time, like water, you put the glasses on, it goes from being one thing to another. So its underlying message is, if you look at me one way, look at me again. Let's have a conversation. Enough with the statements, enough with your opinion. This is about finally entering into privacy, intimacy, where we are naked with each other. And therefore, you can't overpower these forces. And I think the great blessing is they basically, unbidden, leave well enough alone. But the questions that I was asking, I'm convinced, literally with my hand, drew them forth. Because they are not an object or a thing, but living, sentient energy that has to do with the divine progenitors, my work with Tor, and that this human experiment of ours is just that, that it is the suggestion that we actually are the outcome of about 18.5 million years. And the genius going on the planet right now is that it's not an alignment in time, but like a ship going across the ocean and finally coming to the place below. There is a moment of alignment.
And I can't, Leigh, forget the quote from ISO, which I had not memorized the entire Bible. I remembered the quote well enough to look it up. And this is what it says.
Savage.
But your mind is troubled by the number of your guides. Let them now come forward for your salvation. The measurers of the heavens, the watchers of the stars, and those who are able to say from month to month what things are coming to you. Are those your watchers, Leigh?
That's a very wonderful thing you brought up, because in my introduction to the watchers, I started looking into the Book of Enoch, which has the watchers. And I was bowled over, really, by the depth of, even in ancient Egypt, they said they came from the land of the watchers, the ancient ones.
So we're going to have to take a brief break now for our free Dreamlanders.
This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi, in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started.
We're back. We're talking to Leigh McCloskey. You can reach Leigh on the internet at leighmccloskey.com. He's also on Facebook and on Instagram. He warns me that he rarely goes on his Instagram account. So beware if you try to reach him on Instagram. Nothing may happen for a long time. In any case, you can reach him. And Leigh, the groups you have, can people, what happens? I know that they're not exactly closed, but if someone were to want to join the group, the Tuesday group in particular, which is a more general conversation, what would they do?
In the old days before the pandemic, because we always had public gatherings here, as a matter of fact, we had up to five every week. Usually when someone was interested, we'd get a chance to meet and just say hello and talk a little. And then, you know, I'd invite them to the group, which is really why I think it's always been such a fascinating and diverse group. I would probably say that during the pandemic, simply because Zoom is problematic, that to contact me or even contact Whitley, especially if you're friends with Whitley, and let us know, because it really is trying to always call a gathering of minds, not a think tank where everyone has a certain level of this or that. What I like is there's a diverse a very diverse background that is actually the glue that binds us together is shared curiosity.
And so yeah, it's about questioning, not about beliefs and sharing. We don't argue or talk politics or anything like that.
Yeah, yeah.
It's about deeply questioning these books that we read. And we've read things like The Red Book by Carl Jung. We've read, Emerson a number of times.
Yeah, yeah.
And Leigh spent many years reading theosophy. Which book did you
25.
Read?
Well, 25 years. I hosted, and that was why, because theosophy is primarily an Eastern esotericism, meaning looking at occult and esoteric philosophy, and I wanted to balance it with Western esotericism and the relationship to the Christian ethos. So theosophy was wonderful because it, in the writings of H.P. Blavatsky, and it was through the ULT, or the United Lodge of Theosophy, and they have study groups, and I inherited the Malibu study group because Carolyn Van Horn, it was at her house, and she became our first Malibu mayor, and then it moved to my home. Every Tuesday night for 25 years, we read everything from Ocean of Theosophy, the Bhagavad Gita, to Patanjali's Yoga Aphorisms, to Letters That Have Helped Me by William Q. Judge, to Transactions of the Blavatsky Lodge, to The Secret Doctrine, which is about 1,300 pages. And so we read that. That was the icing on the cake. The last 9 years we spent reading The Secret Doctrine. What I love about it is, and I felt was very important, was that as a study group, there were a small group of very serious students, meaning people that really did devote themselves to the text and the ideas and the conversation. And it helped me greatly to develop what I consider a philosophical mind, because one really does have the opportunity to begin to see not just one's own point of view and whether you agree or don't agree with some esoteric template or proposition, but actually as in theater, that as the ideas were mulled over and talked about, they lit up in ways and they inspired me so greatly that it really did to a great degree also help with what I call the mythological and archetypal spine of my work on the tarot. So it was an invaluable 25 years. And then as I called him, my old Brahmin, my dear friend Dallas, he finally passed. And with that, it was like sort of lay the, you know, it was to honor the secret doctrine is done. Dallas is done. So now we'll open up Tuesday night to really, as you said, everything from Jung's The Red Book to Man and His Symbols to Perennial Philosophy of Huxley. All of the books that we talk about and would love to have some to talk about with them. And that's what I think this is, do you know?
that's what it is now. And we're just getting started with a very deep book of physics. We've never done physics before, and it should be very interesting. Now, but let me go back. When you mentioned Dallas, what were you talking about exactly?
Actually, it was Dallas Tenebrum. That was his name, and his wife Valerie. They he had lived in Belgium for 35. He had in India, and so he was my Brahmin. He was the one that, because you can tell I probably have fairly wild ideas, and he was that wonderful counterweight for me that would always say, "Who is the I that is speaking? What is the I?" And those questions, though, allow you to move past the and certainly I had it, thinking, well, if it makes sense to me, it must make sense to anyone, only to realize, no, Leigh, they have a glazed look in their eye. Maybe your communication is not as effective as you think. So it helped me greatly.
You are what we think of as an American original, I think. Your art is not of any school, and the modern art movement is in a completely different space from Leigh McCloskey. You do your own thing. You do what you want to do. And I want you to talk to us a little bit about your art and its relationship to the feminine, which I think is very extraordinary. And while we're talking, I will put up on the video show, some of the imagery that we're talking about. And for those of you listening on audio, please go to Unknown Country and or rather to LeighMcCloskey.com to look at some of his art as we talk. Okay, Leigh, so take it away and tell us a little bit about your art and its significance.
I appreciate what you said, Whitley, about it being unique, because I really always point out, I never set out to be original. I never set out to be unique. I was always really about the nature of asking questions with my art. And I felt that great art comes from grappling with ideas that are greater than the artist, rather simply than the illustrating of the things we either are for or against, or what we think we know. And the question of the feminine, as you asked, if we think about our design, so to speak, and the masculine and feminine, not being girl or boy, but the ego being the outward thrusting into the world, having to prove something, having to make a way, having to find out who we are, and thinking that as the masculine, meaning the outward thrust, but that the feminine becomes the invitation, the grace inwardly that says, come home, be with me, be intimate. Know love. Realize that if you know love, it is becoming worthy of what you seek to know. And this is not something you take. It's not something you're entitled to. And that's why I do feel that the greatest importance to my art is that it is my home. Because we all know our home is sacred. When we look at our children's faces, or our wife, or our husband, or our grandchildren, we know love. We know what we would die for. We know what we would defend under any circumstance. And this is why I feel that this art is also the product of where it was located. I live on ancient, sacred Chumash land. The beings that were the Chumash and are the Chumash, they were peoples that did not have a word for war, who lived in peace here for 10,000 years. And being here and being from this area, I have always felt a custodial responsibility that this is a gift to be here. It is not a right. It's not an entitlement. And it's not a place where I can build a high wall and remind myself how important I am. It is a place that says, you are here, you are a custodian, and you are responsible. And so all of my art, in a way, came from the response. I never thought my art is almost funny to me. It's like, I never knew I was this talented. It's sort of like playing King Lear and going, wow, that was really pretty good. Or picking up a guitar and understanding that maybe you have some gift for it. Because what happened here was that I really would say that between my tarot work and my work on the Codex Tour, which again, we'll give examples of, but I spent 25 years working on two books that I had bound, and I used these 500 images as a way of exploring the nature of inner space, the nature of multidimensionality, and using the tool of creation to explore the nature of creation. And that's what this art is. What's also very interesting is it's a cave painting. So if we think about this, right, this is the oldest technology.
Yeah, you are literally in a cave. This is a cave painting.
And I'm a kid.
And Free Dreamlanders, there's something else going on here, which we have to take another brief break, and we'll come back with Leigh McCloskey. As always, subscribers will just keep right on keeping on.
It seems that in-person conferences are finally coming back. I'm going to be at the Conscious Life Expo, February 4th through 7th, at the LAX Hilton near Los Angeles Airport. It's going to be quite a conference. I'm going to be talking about my new book, about them, a deep look into just
who our visitors are through the medium of what they do. It's going to be a very interesting talk, I can assure you. A lot of friends are going to be there. Jacques Vallée is going to be there. Jimmy Church is going to be there. George Noory is going to be there. It's quite a big group. Bashar will be there. I haven't seen Bashar in a long time. William Henry, Linda Moulton Howe will be there. All kinds of great people. Adam Apollo is going to be there. Alan Steinfeld will be there. All kinds. It's just a wonderful lineup of extraordinary people. So go to ConsciousLifeExpo.com and you'll be there too. We'll see you at the expo. I can't believe after all this time, I am finally able to say those words.
We're back with Leigh McCloskey. We've been talking about, well, a number of things about the hieroglyph. I think that we saw in your on your couch beside you a cat. And I think it's important that we talk a little bit about your relationship to cats. And you've had some remarkable cats. I remember Hunam very vividly as one of the most remarkable and frankly strangest animals I've ever seen. But tell us a little bit about your cats.
Well, if I can wax a little about my beloved Hunan, who passed about 5 years ago. He was the touchstone that allowed all of this to emerge. And the first being that, because I used to always, when people would say they talked with their animals, I thought, no, it was an actor. I thought, yes, it's an appreciation. Well, he was the one that really broke the ice. And I heard him say distinctly, I'm far more ancient than you. I'm not fascinated with the memory systems you seem so compelled by. I live in the ever vital now. So I ask you, which one of us is the primitive? And the conversation with the cat and with my other cats, I really feel this feline sense, especially if you think about it. Now, this goes back to my life as an actor as well, is that when you're in a creative process, let's say you're playing a character or painting a painting, you have no idea how to do it or what you're doing. And so you begin to listen with different ears. You listen for that inner voice of, well, try this, try that. And I really found that was so helpful because it allows what is known as the suspension of disbelief, meaning if I don't have to say this is true or not true, then I can really enjoy what's coming to me. At Hunan, I mean, I love one of the things that he also informed me was that love is love, regardless of form. And that's always stuck with me. And that's why I do. I feel that these emissaries of love, our dogs and our cats, what is so generous about them is that they're willing to be anything from companions to even food when you think about the animal kingdom.
Yeah.
But when we start to really relate to the spirit, to that which is within them, we begin to perceive that they really are, in their own way, a very exalted quality of consciousness that has great patience with us because we are always conditional, whereas they speak the language of love. And the language of the love of cats as well teaches etiquette, not of the love that simply takes because it is always there, but the love that actually responds because there really are etiquette, manners in a relationship, meaning that if you enjoy this, then let's make this about us rather than me satisfying something for you. And so they've really taught me about why, and with the heron visiting me in 2005, when the heron came into the house and stood on the couch, I inwardly heard, you know I'm a bird, you know I'm a symbol, but what you don't yet realize is I am the quality of consciousness that ascends and returns. And the reason I don't speak to you with words is I teach you to trust your inner storyteller. And this is what I felt with and feel with my cats as well, is that there's, and I did with my dogs, who are both passed now, but there are all of these relationships waiting to be known by us, but we have, in a way, because of habitual lessening of our sensitivity to these things, just looked at them as less than or not that, as opposed to companions who speak very different languages. And if we listen, who knows what insights and wonders might awaken. And that has been the truth here.
Well, that, you know, that's a very important statement, because we don't, we look down on them basically because they have no hands and they can't talk. Yeah. But yeah, if they had hands and could talk, it might be a very different world. And in any case, let's move on now. Oh, by the way, that quote from Isa, if anyone wants to read it, it's Isa 47:13. I know that I had to look up the quote, but I have done that now, and so it's Isa 47:13. Let's go on now, Leigh. I'd like to circle back to your acting career just for a bit. Can you tell us a little? You went to Juilliard, and in New York, and can you tell us a little? You were on Dallas, as I recall.
Yeah, I was one of those. I was very fortunate in that I studied at the Juilliard School under the direction of John Houseman in the early days of the Juilliard School. I was in group six, and my roommate was Kelsey Grammer, and Robin Williams was in my class. It was really quite Bill Hurt. There were all of these remarkable actors either in the class or in the class above us. And it was quite the remarkable mix of talent, a lot of raw talent, a lot of people excited about the possibility of things. And I was a Malibu kid that had gotten out of high school early, had gone to college at Northridge, and then auditioned and was one of the handful that got in. And I was convinced, well, they must have made a mistake. And then I asked others and they said, no, we felt the same way, because it was very difficult. But when I came back out to California, kismet or luck of good fortune, I ran into an agent when I was living in a hotel, Olcott, in New York, and she invited me out to California. And I took her up on that after my second year. And I came out and did a lot of different television work. Executive Suite was my first series, which was interesting because it was interracial. I had a black girlfriend, Brenda Sykes, in 1975. So I felt like in the 70s, it was interesting. I was in shows that were asking questions. Like, I did TV movies. One was called Dawn, Portrait of a Teenage Runaway, and the other was Alexander, The Other Side of Dawn. And it really looked at hustling and street life and teenage prostitution and the gay lifestyle in Alexander. And I really felt that they were asking questions. And I did a paper chase where I played a very manipulative paraplegic character. So there was these very fascinating characters that I was doing in the late 70s. And then in 1980, I was cast as Mitch Cooper in the hit show Dallas, playing Lucy Ewan's boyfriend and then husband, Charlene Tilton. And so I did that for a couple of years, a couple of seasons, and then went back every now and then to say, are you coming with me or not? And in the meantime, I was doing different movies like Dario Argento's Inferno and some other things that sort of got even Bermuda Depths and ABC. Rankin Bass film has a type of cult following, because I really think that certain movies, when we're a certain age, we see them, and therefore they take on this whole coming of age quality.
Yes,
and I guess
they do.
One of those films that has that. And then I did daytime Santa Barbara. I played Zach Hilton, and then who went crazy, and I played a lot of psychopaths. I did. Yeah, it's funny. I went from playing good guys and nice guys to playing. I got really tired of yeah. Just, I do it well, but I just I say playing rich guys and jerks, you know, I can do, but I enjoy the ones where it's more of a...
Yeah, they get under your skin, the characters, don't they, a little bit?
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's funny with my work on General Hospital. I played a character, Damian Smith, and for me, there's an interesting irony with President Trump, because he had, if we think about Trump, Trump is what the archetypes are called. They're called Trumps. And I had in General Hospital, Damian Smith, because he was sort of a gangster. And I was really, you know, everyone has a price. I'm not interested in whether you're good or bad. I'm interested in your effectiveness. Are you effective? You're on my team. You're ineffective. You're not on my team. So I modeled it after actually Donald Trump of the 90s, because I thought, who is it that really represents these? So there's this strange relationship between my having brought 22 Trumps through the tarot in this relationship to a character based on that, this character himself. And then, so something in this, it was a bit like when I was working on my couch, my sofa, when George Bush was working on the Status of Forces Agreement. So I'd have the news on and I hear him going, well, you know, it's about the sofa. And I'm painting a sofa at the same time. And I thought, well, Brother George, you are asking the question of the Status of Forces Agreement in one direction, and I'm asking them in another. And of course, my pun was I was recouching our understanding of things by using art rather than war. But that's just me.
Well, now I want to get in a little while more deeply into the tarot. But before we go there, I think I'd like to talk a little bit about the Malibu fires, the recent ones. Malibu burns fairly often, about every 5 years. But before I ask Leigh to let me set the scene, a couple of years ago, there was a terrible fire, truly the worst fire in Malibu's history. And the hieroglyph is in Malibu. It's right there. And those of us who have been part of the hieroglyph for all of these years were naturally terribly upset and frightened. And Leigh and Carla stayed with the house because, for reasons of their own, the Malibu powers that be directed the fire department to stand down. And so they didn't have any fire support. Some of us, not me, others walked in for miles and miles with fire extinguishers and so forth to the house. And Leigh and Carla struggled on alone. And then there were many efforts made to save the house using extraordinary means. And a group of us in Leigh's groups got together at my apartment, and we created an orb of protection around the house. And I should really give you an idea of how to do this. You have to get your attention into your body, and then move it out, all the way out, not just to the place that you seek to protect, but to all, asking for protection, and take from us what you need the most and give us what we need, and then bring it back and surround the place you need protected. And we did that, and there were other things being done. And Leigh, tell us about what it was like when the house was saved.
Well, this was November 9th, 2018, which was the Woolsey Malibu Park fire. And I've grown up out here. So as you said, I've been through many fires, but I'd never seen a fire like this. I was greeted by a fire tornado. And I was, as we do, growing up out here, you don't leave. Everyone had left, but I was old school, so we were not leaving, and there was no way I could leave any more than a captain could desert his ship. And I had a smaller painting of mine that I was going to put in the car just to take it down to Zuma Beach, try and get something down to Zuma Beach. But this fire went from being on a ridge to being at our door in about 20 minutes. And I opened the downstairs door, and I was greeted by absolute pitch blackness and stillness, with beautiful red, golden, really looking like just like they were rain, just gently falling. And it was so surreal, because it was really like opening the door and seeing the face of a dragon. You've never seen such a thing, and I never had. And in that moment, not only did I see it and it was still, it then went into motion, a bit like when something goes back into motion, and it went, and as it turned, it thrust me, really like I was punched in the chest. It thrust me. It even bent the painting back. I could see it bow, and we went toppling back into the house. But I had this very odd reaction. I was not afraid. It was as if I pulled a broadsword, like it really was a dragon. I was not going to try and run and hide, so to speak, but really charged right back at it. And that's when I heard the fire say, "Are you staying or going?" And I said, "Staying." And that I heard inwardly. That's all I needed to know. And this fire was apocalyptic. It was sentient. 3 days into it, it hissed at me, "Tell me what you hate and I'll burn down your house." It was a fire that was seeking a type of, you would say, apocalyptic vengeance on the human beings that were no longer honoring anything other than what they hated, that they had forgotten community. And it hit us. Now, you have to understand, the ocean's right out there. So it came to as far as it could burn, from coast to coast. It hit us 2 years after the election. Of the election, meaning that there was such outrage going on between people, between neighbors knowing what they hated about each other. And this fire was really, it was a type of infernal dragon. But my trees told me, we are not fuel, we are guardians. My garden told me that everything in this garden is alive. Everything alive wants to live. You're the part of the garden that is in motion. We have your back. And so I started not fighting nature, but working with nature, again, like my cats, feeling this greater energy at my back. And when you talk about what you did, Whitley, and the prayer circle, and this is why, I mean, with an acting career, you know, you're always in a way an improvisatory yes, because you're trying to, you know, do you feel the energies? Of course I do, even if you don't, just because you're allowing it to, in a way, not stop, where you go, "I don't feel anything." You just allow it to go. But this was very different. This was palpable. This was 2 a.m. that night, Friday night. I'm exhausted. We're all exhausted. And it is burning around us like really Dante's Inferno. It's burning in front of me. It's burning behind me. It's burning to the side of me. Houses are on fire with such ferocity that you can see them literally outlined in fire. You can see the pillars, you can see the windows, you can see everything, but they're burning so bright. And then houses are exploding and moaning, and gas tanks are just continually going off, and you'll see something sparkling, and then sparkle, and then it explodes. So it was this incredible otherworldly setting. But then I heard 2 a.m. "Do you feel everyone's prayers for you and Carla and Olandar?" Olandar is the name of our home. And I said, "Yes." I could feel it palpably. And this is what I started to realize. It was a moment of great trauma. And therefore, all the shielding of, well, what do I do next? Do I have to go to the market? That was gone. The only question, are we going to survive the night? What do we have to do? Where do I have to attend? What do I have to knock down? What do I have to put out? And when the prayer field, when I felt that, I felt a dome placed over the house. And this is what Whitley was talking about. Because that's the pattern the fire burned. It burned around us like a dome is over us. And I am convinced, that's why I tell everyone that came here, everyone that has loved this place and honored it, loved the art, loved Carl and me, all of that. We felt it. And that's why the power of prayer, the power of love, they're not the things we will see in the ordinary world because we're too busy. But let me tell you, when there is nothing to concentrate on other than survive the night, you feel the energies and you know it. And it didn't feel like a guarantee, but it felt like I had angels at my back. And you know, Whitley, I just say publicly bless you and for doing that. And anybody else that took part, it was extraordinary. It was affirming for everything that we think about. And yet when we become cynical because we're so disappointed at this point, we say, nah, it doesn't matter. Well, yes, it does. So thank you, Whitley.
Well, you don't need to thank me. Thank you for staying and surviving. But, you know, I don't go out of my body. I can't go on my own, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But I ended up out of my body that night at about 2 a.m. And I went to the house. And I was in the house. You were there. You were wide awake, which you naturally would be. And I saw the way those curtains that you usually leave open had been pulled closed. And I had a pretty good experience of the extraordinary sense of, I would say, sacred and holiness in the house, that it has been there. You've been doing this for so many years. This place is a concentration of spiritual energy and of a place where so much effort has been made and so many journeys have taken place. And goodness knows what the Chumash Indians did in this space for thousands of years, because, you know, this is, folks, a place where Anne, after she passed away, the most incredible experience I ever had of seeing Anne again happened there at Olandar. So I was there anyway, and there was a woman there. She was dressed in black, but that is many people in that state are dressed in black. She was not a physical person. She was a spirit. And I've often wondered who it was. I know we've talked about this before personally, Leigh, and you said it might have been your mother, but she seemed to be really protective. And I thought to myself, as you were talking just now, that you may have been feeling her presence as she made her own effort to connect with the energy of the fire. Do you have anything to say about that possibility?
It's very interesting that you bring this up, because your observation and with your sensitivity, I really do feel that intuitively that would be so, because there was a wonderful man, Kyle, I forget his last name at the moment, but he's quite a gifted sensitive. And he called or wrote about that he had perceived my father. And he said things about that I said, oh, my God, that's, you know, what my father would say, because my father had a pretty gruff sense of humor at times. But that he was blowing away. He saw him blowing, like in that dome, that my father had told Kyle, I will not let this burn. And I wouldn't doubt, because I was very, very close with both my parents in terms that they really were ancient comrades that took on the role of my parents in this, and really were I realized the great givers of both chivalry and etiquette in terms of how we treat one another and what we and how we spend our time and what we devote our energies to. So even if it was not that, it was that, because it makes perfect sense to my heart that it would be.
You know, you said something a few minutes ago that really struck me very forcibly, that we have come to a point in our world, in the United States in particular, where we only honor our hate, what we hate. And I don't want to get into a political discussion, because this isn't a political show and it just makes people mad. And I don't blame them. I mean, we're not here to discuss politics. We are here, though, to discuss the human spirit and the human soul and where we are going as human beings. And I think that is a very important statement, because we have drifted into a kind of state of generalized hate, as you were describing, where, like in any community, the people who are for one side or another politically generally are no longer willing to live with and interact with the other side. And I find that horrifying. I'm not like that. I have friends who are on every side of every political issue you can imagine around the world. Yeah. And you do too. Yeah.
I do too. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
So tell us a little bit about this. Not so much, I mean, we all know we're too much honoring hate. What can we do to change, Leigh? Where can we go from here?
You know, a part of what I heard on, as I said, because this fire was endless. And so on the third night, winds came back, and all of the things that had gone to embers came back, and everything was back full fury. And at this point, there's no psychic resistance to anything. And that's where it was. I really felt like it was something out of a Stephen King novel, where the energies themselves are sentient, like the house energies. But this fire was a living, breathing force. And I felt it wrap itself around me like a boa constrictor, like it wanted to extinguish the life from me. And it was, and that's when I heard this really just hideous voice saying, "Tell me what you hate, like you. Tell me what you hate, and I'll burn down your house." And it went into this story that, and because I'm not really an apocalyptic thinker, but it started to say that this fire was the apocalypse, that the apocalypse doesn't happen all at once, but that this is a great fire, and that it even said that the four horsemen in the tarot are death, temperance, the tower, and judgment. And it's very interesting because it's not political, but the Trump Tower. The tower is the 16th key. The 16th key is Mars. Mars is about aggression, about anger and fire and fury and setting everything ablaze if it is not controlled. And this is what we were experiencing directly, was neighbor hating neighbor. And I felt this dragon rising, saying, "I am a fire." And this was before COVID. It said, "I am a fire that will seek out the drought in the human heart. I will find this brittleness, and I will destroy it from within. No wall will be high enough, no gate great enough. These forces are that which destroy universes." So when you think on that level of force, and we are, as you say, just becoming less and less and less, and knowing what we hate, forgetting what we love, and that the fire will find. That's why it isn't just a matter of, boy, wouldn't it be nice if we were nicer? This has to do with, again, if you think about the ego, and I thought about myself as the white guy sitting on Indian land. Indians didn't leave here because they wanted to. So what do I do with that? And I learned in Cambodia in the killing fields, when I was overwhelmed with soul trauma, of what do you do with the evil? What do you do with the hundreds of thousands of people brutally murdered in the soil? What do you do with that? You can't say, "Well, it was karma. Ah, bad luck." And that's when I realized it, because it told me, the heart of darkness said, "Do not look into me. I will devour you. Look to the eyes of the children. Look to the smiles. Look to the heart. Look to the love of things. Look to generation." And it was this lesson that you are to be a guardian, a witness, like a librarian, not to be a judge of these things. That just as in the library, there are books we don't like and stories of being human that we do not particularly want to call our own, but they're still part of the story. And so this fire and this time we're in is not a story where I am leaning over the fence telling my neighbor what's wrong with him or how he should vote. I am in my home looking at those I love and saying, "At least here, let me begin this story with, you know what I love? rather than, you know who I hate, you know who I blame. And I'll tell you, when I came back from out with my fire extinguisher, putting out the burning timbers and fighting in this absolute chaos of smoke and embers, I told Carla, I said, I feel like a Zen master. I don't blame anybody. You could show me somebody with a match saying, he set this fire. And I would have said, peace, brother. Because I realized that's not my role in this. My role is to find a center in the middle of a storm, to be a navigator of my circumstance rather than a reactor, rather than figuring out how to reset my gun to shoot again. And that's boy, we are so manipulated by this.
So truly, how do we live in such a way that we aren't always recocking our guns to shoot again? Live in a higher space. Now, Free Dreamlanders, speaking of higher spaces, we're going into a higher space with Leigh in a few minutes, but you're going to stay behind. We'll be talking about the tarot more deeply, perhaps, than you will ever have heard before about this extraordinary book, Revisioning the Tarot, which you can get on Amazon for about $35, I think. And you can get it, in fact, through Unknown Country. You can click on it, click through the website and get it. So we'll be right back.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.